an Airbus A320 from Taca Airlines, faces trouble during landing. The pilots struggle to slow the aircraft, but nothing works. On the brink of a terrible accident, the plane doesn't seem to reduce speed, and the runway is quickly running out. Join me as we investigate what happened to Taca Flight 390. May 30, 2008. At El Salvador International Airport, just before 9 a.m., the star of this story is ready, an Airbus A320 from Taca Airlines. This aircraft was built in the year 2000 and began service with Taca in 2001. Over the years, it was leased twice to Cubana de Aviación between 2001 and 2007, and even carried Martinair's livery for a time. Transportes Aéreos del Continente Americano S.A., or simply Taca, was a Salvadoran airline owned by Kingsland Ltd. On May 28, 2013, it began operating under the commercial brand Avianca. Founded in 1931 in Honduras, Taca officially joined the Star Alliance on June 21, 2012. By 2013, it was recognized as the second oldest airline in Central America and the Caribbean. On May 28, 2013, Taca completed its merger with the Colombian airline Avianca. Taca had an extensive network of routes throughout the continent, using a multi-hub system. On the ground, fueling and luggage loading were underway while the cockpit crew prepared for Flight 390. Their destination? Miami International Airport, with two stops along the way. Toncontín International Airport in Tegucigalpa, and Ramon Villeda Morales International Airport in San Pedro Sula. The Flight 390 crew included Captain Cesare Eduardo de Antonio Mena, with 11,800 flight hours, 8,500 of them on the Airbus A320. First Officer Juan Rodolfo Artero Arevalo, with 1,100 flight hours, 250 of them on the Airbus A320. Four cabin crew members supporting the 118 passengers on board. In total, there were 124 souls aboard the Airbus A320 bound for Miami. For this flight, the first officer would pilot the plane while the captain managed communications. With preparations complete and all passengers seated, the captain ordered the doors closed to begin pushback and engine startup.
Taca 390 solicitando autorización para carreteo a pista establecida para despegue.
Autorizado para carretear a pista. Notifique cuando estén listos para el despegue.
While taxiing to the runway, in the cockpit, both pilots focus on preparing the aircraft for takeoff and the flight ahead. And in the rear of the aircraft, the crew is in charge of issuing the respective safety warnings and instructions to the passengers. Shortly after 9 a.m., the aircraft reached the runway threshold, ready for takeoff to its first stop in Honduras. The takeoff was smooth, and the plane climbed to the altitude specified in its flight plan for the first leg of the journey. The flight proceeded without any issues until preparations began for descent into Toncontín, the first stop.
Por favor, prepara la aeronave para el descenso a Toncontín. Parece que el clima va a empeorar a medida que estemos más cerca del aeropuerto. Mientras, yo me encargaré de las comunicaciones de radio.
Entendido.
Torre, aquí Taca 390, solicitando autorización para iniciar el descenso a Toncontín.
Taca 390 autorizado. Descienda y manténgase a 11.000 pies y espere nuevas instrucciones.
As the descent began, weather conditions worsened. A tropical storm was hitting the Pacific coast and moving south toward Honduras. This caused reduced visibility at Toncontín due to low clouds and heavy rain. Toncontín Airport posed significant challenges due to its location in a valley surrounded by mountains and its short 1,800-meter runway. Although both the captain and first officer had landed here several times, it was always a demanding task, especially with the adverse weather. Approaching the airport, the tower instructed them to land on runway 20 due to strong winds blowing from south to north. However, the pilots chose runway 02, which aligned with the wind direction. The plane aligned with the runway for final approach. At the last moment, the pilots aborted the landing and executed a go-around, likely due to instability or a higher than normal descent rate and speed caused by the bad weather. Despite the go-around and a suggestion to divert to a nearby airport, the captain decided to attempt another landing on runway 02 at Toncontín.
Damas y caballeros, les habla su capitán. Hemos realizado una maniobra de aproximación debido al mal tiempo en Tegucigalpa. Intentaremos otra aproximación para aterrizar en la misma pista. Se trata de un procedimiento rutinario y no hay motivo de alarma. Les mantendremos informados.
The captain considered diverting to San Pedro Sula if the second attempt failed, but pressed ahead with the current approach. The tower again suggested changing runways due to the severe weather, but the final decision rested with the captain. For the second attempt, the pilots configured the aircraft with maximum brakes, fully extended flaps, and activated spoilers to prepare for the challenging landing. However, the aircraft was above the maximum landing weight due to excess fuel, impacting braking distance and control. The plane touched down 400 meters past the runway threshold at approximately 150 knots. The pilots applied maximum brakes, thrust reversers, and spoilers, but hydroplaning on the rain-soaked runway reduced traction. Despite their best efforts, the aircraft skidded off the runway at about 50 knots. Crashing into nearby roads and vehicles before stopping in a dirt embankment. Tragically, the captain and two passengers lost their lives, along with two people on the ground trapped in vehicles crushed by the aircraft. According to investigations conducted by the Civil Aviation Authority of El Salvador, one of the main causes of the accident was the crew's inappropriate decision to proceed with the landing, despite the severe conditions on the runway. Additional factors included strong tailwinds of approximately 12 knots, the aircraft's excessive weight due to the large amount of fuel needed for the journey to Miami, and the water accumulation on the runway caused by the tropical storm, which led to hydroplaning. This prevented the aircraft from decelerating properly on the wet surface. Another critical factor was the aircraft's high approach speed to the runway, likely influenced by the strong winds hitting the plane during its descent. Although both pilots had previous experience landing at this challenging airport, the combination of these factors played a crucial role in their decision-making, which was not thoroughly assessed during earlier phases of the flight. Regarding the runway, it was determined that, at the time of the accident, it lacked an adequate grooving system necessary for effective water drainage. This led to significant water pooling across the surface. In-depth studies indicated that the aircraft could have potentially stopped if the runway had been a bit longer or if there had been no standing water on its surface. Thanks to this terrible accident, the government of Honduras ordered the temporary closure of the airport to carry out corrective and updating work in order to provide better service for both domestic and international flights. I remind you that the purpose of this type of investigation is to inform about the events that occurred and never to discredit or put the credibility of the people involved at risk.